At 7:58 a.m. on April 3rd, 2024, Taiwan experienced a big earthquake, measured at magnitude 7.2. As of this writing, there are 13 dead and nearly 1,000 are injured, mostly due to rock falls. There are a few people trapped for whom rescue efforts are ongoing. Life is precious, and my heart goes out to the victims and their families. Of course, people want to know about the fabs. They're fine. TSMC and other semiconductor companies across Taiwan are reporting that the financial impact will be minimal. It's a huge contrast to the last big earthquake back in 1999, which staggered the Hsinchu tech companies and made the world news. What changed? In this video, we look at the measures that TSMC and other semiconductor companies undertook in wake of the 1999 earthquake to keep their fabs and people safe. Taiwan's most infamous earthquake in recent memory occurred in September 1999, the 921 earthquake. It was a magnitude 7.3 quake that hit the central area of Nantou. Over 2,400 people died and 11,000 were injured, the second most in Taiwan's history after another quake in 1935. TSMC, UMC, and other major electronics companies were then highly concentrated within Hsinchu. They were unprepared for the earthquake and brought the chip makers to a standstill. In the end, TSMC reported that 17,000 wafers were lost as they were inside process equipment at the time, about 50% of their total monthly production. No one else reported official numbers on wafer losses. Worse yet, the earthquake came as suppliers were ramping up for a holiday in the midst of a secular rising trend. Demand for TSMC silicon in 1999 was up 40% from 1998, leading to shortages for PC and electronics companies in Japan and the United States. Total damages for the Taiwanese semiconductor industry, at a time when TSMC was only responsible for 7% of global IC production, were $10 billion, or about $18 billion today. But this number is more nuanced than what you might think. More on that later. Back in 1999, the fabs owned by TSMC and other semiconductor makers in Taiwan featured a double shell structure. On the outside, you have a fab shell. The fab shell is a simple one-story structure with long-span roof trusses. That just means that the roof is built to span wide distances without the need for interior supports. Inside the shell is a multi-story interior structure made from reinforced concrete. The clean room sits on the top floor with a second clean room, quote-unquote sub-fab, below it to house supporting equipment. There is an air gap between the shell and interior structure to shelter the clean room from micro vibrations coming from the outside winds. Both structures sit on a concrete foundation of about 2 to 3 meters thick. Again, this is to minimize vibrations from nearby cars and construction. Piles might be driven into the soil as needed. The civil construction is about 3 to 5% of the fab's total cost. As mentioned, the vast majority, 75 to 80%, goes to the equipment inside. This means a little bit of extra investment can go a long way. The 1999 earthquake's epicenter was about 100 kilometers away from Hsinchu, where the science park is based. Peak ground acceleration, or PGA, the acceleration of the ground at the earthquake's worst, was measured at 0.1 to 0.15 g-forces. This is as expected for a 7.2 earthquake about 100 kilometers away from the fabs. For reference, the Taiwan government measured the April 2024 earthquake's impact on Hsinchu similarly. Based on this map and my eyeballing, Hsinchu experienced a PGA of about 140 centimeters per second squared, or 0.14 g. The PGA in Tainan, where TSMC's biggest manufacturing complexes are located, was even lighter, 25 centimeters, or 0.025 g-forces. In the case of 1999, structural damage was reported as minimal, with the exception of one Hsinchu site sitting on an ancient lake bed. Mostly minor cracking of external tiles, as well as cracks in the internal walls. Inside the structures, it is estimated that the amount of acceleration needed to move an average piece of equipment sitting on the clean room floor was measured to be 0.2 g-forces. This implies that friction alone would keep most unanchored tools grounded. Observation reports found that most tools were unanchored except for those containing hazardous chemicals. Since the clean room sits on top of a multi-story concrete structure, there is a chance of vibrations intensifying like a Jenga tower. Furthermore, there is a chance of secondary quake damage. Wafer processing requires the use of poisonous and hazardous chemicals like hydrofluoric and sulfuric acid. Leakages can cause massive problems to the cleanroom. But modern semiconductor facilities have systems that shut down pipes when unnatural vibrations are detected. These worked as expected, no problems there. Apparently, there were some reports of wet-etch tools, basically chemical baths where you dip wafers into to etch them, splashing their chemicals during the shaking, but those flowed into the disposal system and little damage was reported. And then it was reported that the sprinklers went off at one factory at Hsinchu, unclear which companies, and that ruined one photolithography machine and significantly damaged another. The most significant equipment damage from the 1999 earthquake was to the vertical diffusion furnaces. As the name indicates, these are furnaces used to diffuse impurities into the silicon. These are often used during the doping part of the semiconductor manufacturing process. The quote-unquote vertical part of the name indicates that it stands up vertically, allowing us to process batches of wafers all at once. They can be up to 3 meters tall. 90% of these furnaces were damaged by the 1999 earthquake, with damage defined as silica tube damage, position gaps, or wafers falling off their securings. Apparently because the furnace itself is so tall and thin, it is quite susceptible to shaking. In 2013, the Japanese construction company Taisei Corporation reported that they installed a seismic isolation tool to deal with this. It is basically like a rollerball on rail system that you put under the row of furnace devices. The furnace pulls in gas and electricity from a secondary system underneath the floor, so the seismic isolation system includes a flexible piping system to ensure the connections under the floor do not break. That same year, TSMC reported in a case study that they had installed a similar seismic isolation platform for their vertical furnace tools. A major cause of wafer damage during the 1999 earthquake occurred through damage to the stalkers. Work-in-progress wafers do not travel around the fab exposed. They are enclosed within pods called FOUPs, front-opening unified pods. When waiting for their next process step, for whatever reason, the wafers and their FOUPs are stored on vertical shelves called stalkers. They're typically 4-5 meters tall and made from aluminium. During the 1999 earthquake, many of the wafers fell out of their stalkers and FOUPs and were lost. So the chip makers apparently installed stoppers, braces, and dampers, which are items to reduce shaking, to secure the stalkers. Then in February 2016, there was the Southern Taiwan earthquake, measured at 6.4. It was relatively shallow, 23 kilometers, and the epicenter was in Kaohsiung, not that far away from the Tainan fabs. That Tainan earthquake, because of its proximity to TSMC's core fabs, delayed some 120,000 wafers in fabs 6 and 12A by about 10 to 50 days. During that earthquake, the fab's peak floor acceleration experienced about 0.3 g-forces. But because the stalkers are tall and bolted to the floor, the acceleration forces experienced by the FOUPs were double that. Wafers collided and some fell out. New research suggests that it makes more sense to install the dampers near the top of the stalkers rather than putting them between the neighboring shelves, as was previously suggested. It is not clear if TSMC adopted this, though their 2017 case study suggests they did reinforce their tower stalkers with additional stoppers. The 1999 earthquake made it clear to TSMC and other companies that older fabs had to be retrofitted. Retrofits, of course, are challenging. The sub-fab floor is already full of equipment, leaving limited space for new stuff. Moreover, retrofits cannot affect ongoing semiconductor production. No way they can stop the fab line. We cannot use gas, welding, and must avoid generating dust particles. So TSMC engineers use what are called viscous dampers. These are hydraulic pistons installed into the gap between the external fab shell and the interior structure. During an earthquake, the viscous dampers absorb some seismic energy, dissipating it. Computer simulations of earthquakes, with PGAs of 0.3 g-forces, remember the 1999 earthquake ranged at 0.1 to 0.15, showed reduced stress on supports and cut acceleration of cleanroom floors by 20%. This is good, but it is warned that dampers will not have a significant impact if the building is hit by a major earthquake, especially one more severe than what it is currently designed for. Newer semiconductor fabs built thereafter can be built with modern anti-seismic technologies. This includes raised floors to add a void for seismic isolation and floating piles to dissipate seismic energy in the soil foundation. These were also detailed in the 2017 TSMC case study. After a damaging earthquake in Hualien in 1986, Taiwan developed at least three networks of earthquake sensors located throughout the island. These are operated by various government and university-affiliated organizations. My best guess is that TSMC adopted the network set up by the National Center for Research on Earthquake Engineering, or NCREE, one of Taiwan's national research labs. When an earthquake hits, seismic waves travel outwards from the epicenter like ripples in a pond. First comes the primary waves, or P waves, which are low intensity. After that are secondary waves, or S waves, large surface acoustic waves that travel across the surface. They're slower than the P waves but cause more damage. I mentioned these waves during my video on SAW RF filters. Surface acoustic waves from earthquakes contributed to the early learnings on the science behind those RF products. The early warning network is made up of several dozen stations across Taiwan. Sensors measure the peak ground acceleration for 1 to 3 seconds and send a signal to the central server. The server determines whether there is an earthquake using an algorithm and sends the alert out. Seismic waves can travel 80 kilometers in 15 to 20 seconds. If the early warning system works as planned, then it can give people or a fab about 3 to 17 seconds of warning, depending on where the epicenter is. It was originally used to give early warning to Taiwan's schools, but in late 2015 or early 2016, TSMC had a system installed as well, and it seemed to have played a significant role during the southern Taiwan earthquake that February. I should note that with this 2024 earthquake, a few early warning systems did not trigger. I live in Taipei and did not get a cell phone alert. So, if the 1999 earthquake didn't do that much physical damage to the fabs, then how did it end up so financially damaging? As it turned out, the most financially significant damage wasn't from the quake itself, but from interruptions of power to the fabs in the wake of the quake and its aftershocks. In the weeks after the quake, the Taiwanese government struggled to get the power situation in Hsinchu back under control. This was despite a stated priority to supply the science park with power over even residential homes. When the power to the equipment cuts out, the voltage suddenly drops, creating a situation known as voltage sag. Abruptly pulling the plug on your PC causes damage to it. Not hard to imagine the same thing happening for a $50 million DUV lithography machine. Voltage sags do happen from time to time, even without earthquakes. TSMC memorably froze all production just before January 1st, 2000, because they were worried about the Y2K bug cutting power. After the main earthquake, power interruptions continued for another 2 weeks. The fabs had built emergency measures for voltage sag, but these items were not meant to power the fabs for extended periods of time. So when the power cuts out, the fab people first have to wait until the power comes back to learn the situation. Work in process wafers has to be evaluated and discarded, and another 2 to 3 days are spent to repair and recalibrate the machines. Thus, 95% of the reported $10 billion damages suffered were not from actual physical damage to equipment or facilities, but lost revenues from infrastructure cuts and business interruptions. In 2024, Taiwan's power utility, Taipower, shut down 4 power generation units for checks and cut power on the eastern half of the island. But on the west side, the grid has so far held on, perhaps due to recent buildouts of solar and wind energy. Restarting production will take time and care. Nikkei Asia gives a hint about the work needed to get everything back online. Wafers need to be inspected, the machines need to be tested, and procedures have to be run. It could be a few weeks before everything is 100%. It is an all-hands-on-deck kind of thing, and Taiwanese media reports on full parking lots late into the night in the wake of the earthquake. I know that for some people, the earthquake is only another reminder that Taiwan, or Japan, shouldn't be relied upon for semiconductors. I can see the comments now. Yes, TSMC and the rest of the Taiwanese semiconductor industry have been lucky. There hasn't been a serious quake in Hsinchu since a 6.0 aftershock of the infamous April 1935 earthquake. But earthquakes are a natural phenomena and can hit anywhere. We just had an earthquake hit the New York City area. The bright side is that because they are natural, they can be ameliorated through good engineering, best practices, and training. Taiwanese people have been dealing with earthquakes for decades. They know what to do. Alright, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. I really wish the best for the families who have lost loved ones in the 2024 earthquake. I hope they find peace. For everyone else, have a good night, and I'll see you guys next time.